The art museum and all that.
Yeah.
Okay, good morning, everybody.
Yeah, no, I know. I'm just focusing my eyes, but getting heavy.
All right. Already.
I just got in last.
When did you get in last night?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody. Good morning, everybody. We're welcome to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage, and Downtown Development for Tuesday, June 6th. Should I do a leave of absence now? Or I'd like to move a leave of absence for Councillor Schreier away on city business.
So moved. Support.
Okay. Like. Carried. We also have with us, though, we do have with us today Councillor Dobson, Councillor. Councillor Dubassy, Presidente. And then we have Andrew, who's our clerk, will keep us all in flying form. Myself, I'm the chair, John Orlico. And then Mr. Kiernan here is representing the administration and bringing our illustrious crew over as required. So we'll move straight into the agenda. First ups, Andrew. Oh, approval of the minutes. So approved by Councillor Thompson. All supported, opposed, carried.
Aye.
All right, we'll move right into the hearings.
Okay. Good morning. All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the hearing by his decision must fill out a representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table just outside the room. The process the committee will follow is the appellate will be heard first, followed by those in support of the appeal. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the appellant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. Item 1 is an appeal under the vacant building bylaw number 79 of 2010 for the address at 305 Arlington Street. I don't have anyone registered for that matter, so I'm not sure if would you like to go to 2 and 3 and then come back to 1?
Let's do that. The applicants are running late, so we'll move on to items 2 and 3. Okay. By then, we'll go back to 1.
Sure. Item 2 is an appeal under the Planning, Development, and Building Fee Bylaw number 66 of 2016 for 1305 Taylor Avenue. And number 3 is an appeal under the Planning, Development, and Building Fees Bylaw number 66 of 2016 for 1325 Taylor Avenue.
Fantastic. Thank you.
I have Ruben registered as the appellate for both of these matters.
Ruben, if you want to come to the end there, I just want to ask you a question before we start up. Ruben, just because you're pretty well the same appeal for the same the two different buildings,
right?
Can we do them together?
Yes.
Is this okay for you?
Okay.
And yeah, so he'll speak to them together. We'll still vote on them separately.
Okay. Oh, I see. I missed that. Sorry.
No problem.
Yeah.
All right, have you done this before?
I have not done this before.
Very exciting for you. you get the process works is you get 10 minutes to speak about your appeal, and then counselors may ask you questions, may not. And then if there's anybody in opposition to your appeal, they speak or information. And then counselors usually ask the administration some more questions at the time, and then you come back and you can speak to things you've heard, but nothing new information. Fair enough?
Ish? Okay.
We're pretty cash, so so you have about 10 minutes. Go right ahead.
Okay. My name is Ruben Potash. I'm with the company that owns these two buildings, Active Builders Limited. And we filed this appeal because we thought that the imposition of two fines, $5,000 on each building, for breach of the fire safety bylaw 430486 was unfair. I don't know if the meeting has all the documentation that's gone two and four between the appellant and the city on this, but I'll just refer to some of the correspondence that's taken place. The fines were issued according to the correspondence because records indicated that the buildings were in non-compliance, and the dates of the fines were October the 20th, 2016. The fines were the maximum that was permitted to be imposed under the bylaw. The fines were issued by the Department of Planning, Property and Development. The first notice that active builders received was on July the 11th, 2016, by way of correspondence regarding 1305 Taylor, 10-story high-rise building on Taylor. The letter stated that corrections of the deficiencies that had been identified should be completed by September the 16th, 2016. And the letter also indicated that failure to comply could then result in enforcement action. And the letter contained a list of deficiencies under the bylaw. And the deficiencies, and I think I'll read them out because in my view, the deficiencies, although they existed, were minor in nature. And they were really the result of some wear and tear on some of the items that were required under the bylaw, and maybe items that had fallen through the cracks over time. So here are the items. Install heat detectors in storage area under west main floor. What had occurred was a new storage area had been developed, and there was no smoke detector or heat detector installed at the time. It was missed. The next item was crawl space doors in basement to have auto closers. Again, that was missed. Next item, service rooms and stairway doors to have auto closers. And they may have been there. They may have been broken. I'm not sure what the cause was. In any event, in my view, minor non-compliance there. Mail slots and suite entries from corridor to have functioning spring-loaded flaps. Well, they were there, but not all of them were functioning properly. Next item, repair damaged walls in laundry rooms, repair damaged ceilings in main floor security room, repair damaged wall in stairway from 10th floor, and install rated access hatches to replace unrated type in all corridors and stairwells. And lastly, storage room door in west stairwell at main floor to have edges of doors and frame painted with intumescent paint. And my advice is that they were painted, but the labels had been covered, and so they were just identified as non-compliant. So time was given to Active to make the repairs. The repairs were made within the appropriate time given, and that was September the 16th. And Active received confirmation from the inspector in charge indicating that the building was in full compliance by the inspector's letter is February the 16th, 2017. So all the work for the non-compliance was done in accordance with the request. Notwithstanding that, so the work was done by September of 2016. In October of 2016, the fine was imposed. So my argument is that the city waived its right to impose any fine by extending this grace period to active to make the repairs, and that once performance of the repairs was done and the building was in compliance, the city had no further right to impose the fine. And it was contradictory and inappropriate to do so, especially when the fine imposed was for the maximum amount. My arguments for 1325 Taylor, building next door, high-rise building next door, is more or less the same. List of deficiencies, the only difference being most of the non-compliance were of a minor nature, dealing with storage rooms, etc., and crawl spaces, etc. The only difference being that with the second building, 1325 Taylor, there had been a renovation of the boiler room, and a new high-efficiency boiler had been installed, and some holes and minor deficiencies that were left over from the renovation had not been plugged up, basically, in compliance with the bylaw. But notwithstanding that, again, active was given until November of 2016 to complete all the work in the order, and active completed all the work in the order well before the date given. And notwithstanding that, again, the fine was imposed at the same time, October the 20th, 2016. So generally, my argument is that firstly, in this type of situation, fines are not appropriate, and the normal course, I would say, is that notification should be made to the building owner, time granted to make repairs and correct deficiencies, and if there's performance, then that ought to be the end of the matter. And my submission again is that fines are a remedy only with respect to serious breaches of the bylaw, and active has always been in compliance with the bylaw since its issuance in 1986. So what has come up are minor non-compliances that are sort of in the course of normal business. The fines were imposed without checking the record and without looking into the history of this matter. They seem to have been arbitrary and general in nature. And I'm arguing that because active was able to comply with the orders within the time frame granted, that the non-compliance was cured and there was no right at that point in time to impose the fine.
All right.
So, I don't know if this meeting has been provided with all the documentation that I've referred to in my argument.
We have the exhibits, yeah.
You have it all.
Yeah.
And you have the inspector's letter indicating that the buildings are in total compliance.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, that's what I
submit if you can. I do not have correspondence between you and the planning department. All the committee has is the order that was issued to you and the appeal letter that you submitted, as well as my notice letter to you. So if you want to submit anything for the public record, you can do so.
Which notice letter are you referring to?
The notice letter that city clerks provided you about today's meeting.
Oh, well, I can provide copies of all the documentation that I referred to after the meeting if you want to.
We'll have a decision over.
Pardon me?
We'll have a decision by then. So
you think you will?
Yes. So the process now is we listen to your
interview.
Then we'll go through the process. But no, we should have, I can't speak for the committee, but we should have a decision forthwith. For the word A. Yeah.
Your comments are on the public record as well, so the meeting is recorded, so all of that is included.
Okay.
So now, just so you remember, as a newbie, you'll have the opportunity to come back after we've had a discussion with the administration, because they'll respond to some of the things you've indicated in your 10 minutes there, and you can come back and respond again to it. And then after that's concluded, I'll be asking the committee to make a decision to either grant your appeal or not. Fair enough. So just have a seat.
Okay. Can I ask a question?
Oh, that's right. I'm just kidding. Yeah, absolutely.
For the building 1325 Taylor, the department gave you until November 16th to fix?
Yes.
Was that just for the border or was that for everything?
That was for everything. The letter, and it's in the form of an order, dated August the 4th, 2016, provided active with no later than November the 4th, 2016, to remedy all the deficiencies, and that was done. The order contains a list of deficiencies.
Okay. Thank you. That's good.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. That's it for questions for now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else in support of the appeal that wishes to speak? Once, twice, moving on. Anybody in opposition to this appeal that wishes to speak? Once, twice, moving on. Anybody here for information that would like to speak? Once, twice, moving on. Questions of administration?
Yeah, I guess we'd like to just hear from your point of view. Is it accurate that this is in 100% compliance at this point in time?
At this point in time, that's absolutely correct. Both buildings have been brought into compliance, and we are delighted that that's the case.
That's wonderful.
We commend them for taking the actions necessary in order to bring both buildings into compliance. But I'd like to point out that there are some differences. The penalties that have been imposed were part of the enhanced enforcement program. The order that the representative from the ownership company have made.
Excuse me,
are referring to
very well.
Try to speak up. Thank you.
The orders that were received by the company that owns the building were formal orders. What was on the table with those orders is have the work done by the required date or face charges and going to court. Two separate issues.
Can you elaborate that? Maybe clarify that a little bit more.
Our typical process for dealing with noncompliance is to issue a formal order that requires all of the deficiencies to be completed within a specified period of time. If they are not, our next step is to lay charges, take the matter into the court system for enforcement.
So where does we've been seeing a lot of these lately, and we've been getting people who said, oh, we didn't know we had to do this. Well, we've got a $5,000 fine. If they have done all of it, you know, it's pretty good because it's working, and our decision is whether or not we keep that $5,000 fine. Is this, you're saying, something a bit different than that scenario, or is it the same scenario with all of those? That's what I'm really trying to...
This is the same scenario as all of them. This program has been in place for 30 years, approximately. Mm-hmm. And all these buildings had to come up to compliance and have a final report issued. I don't know if it's fully analogous, but maybe like safetying of a car, you know what I mean? And then once that final report is issued, all the ongoing maintenance issues get turned over to fire prevention for ongoing checking and maintenance enforcement. The group of buildings, and during that 30 years, we've been some cases, orders and charges, and right, but there's been a large inventory of buildings that have been very slowly coming into compliance. And there's been a lot of prodding and kind of trying to move these group of building owners forward. This penalty was introduced not for not compliance with the order, as seems to have been kind of interpreted. It was imposed against all buildings that didn't have a final report, that hadn't yet been fully compliant. I'm using the word certified, not legally, but just sort of, you know, kind of that official final report, a stamp of approval. That a few things about the penalty that was imposed. It was imposed as a mechanism to encourage folks. The penalty was imposed for 2016 with an indication that that penalty would double in 2017. Clearly, in this case, we would not be applying the 2017 penalty to this particular building. Another note about the penalty, there's reference to sort of the maximum penalty, implying that there was sort of an opportunity for the public service to impose less or greater. That's not really the case. What's happened here is that it's an imposition of a penalty of $100 per unit to a maximum per building. So if anything, these larger buildings are getting a bit of a break. We got imposed the maximum. There's actually a bit of a break that's imposed because there's fewer or more units, so the cost per unit is actually a little less. The other main impetus here is that the penalty was designed to, bring forward the revenue necessary to pay for the enforcement group that has been paid for by taxpayers up until now to bring these many buildings into compliance over 30 years. So, the penalties together cover the enforcement group's costs and expenses, and there obviously was engagement to the point of inspections and orders, etc., and definitely activity on this property during 2016 that would have incurred expenses. Mm-hmm. So,
once the penalty was the notification, or prior to that, was there?
Sorry, the penalty was applied to all buildings that were still with no final report.
Yeah. But you're saying there was quite a bit of work involved
with all the buildings and engagement. Yeah.
Counselor, I think it's worthwhile to point out that there were at the start of the implementation of the bylaw, there were 3,799 Division I buildings within the city that were required to be inspected and brought into compliance through a phased-in approach by schedule. Since the enhanced enforcement program was established, we started with about 325 buildings that were still not in our records as being fully compliant. And as of last week, the count is at 164. So obviously we're getting there, and it's having the desired effect. We are getting buildings into full compliance. Mm-hmm.
Councillor Dobson.
Yes, I have a question. So you go in and you give them a date that it has to be fixed. And they fix it by that date, apparently. I'm trying to understand why we gave them a date if you're still going to get the fine.
The date you're referring to, Councillor, would have been the date on the formal order that was issued to the building owners advising them that they must bring the building into compliance by that date or face being charged and taken into court.
Okay, so then there's two different things. There's a fine, and then there's a further step. Yeah. So if they don't finish it by that time, they could be taken to that further step.
Correct.
So what you're basically saying is they were going to get the fine anyway.
Correct. Penalty for not being in compliance at the time that the invoices were issued.
All right, so by completing what was required, no further steps are going to be taken, is what you're saying.
This is closed. And no penalty would be charged in 2017.
No.
This year. Okay.
And we certainly are not going to charge them and take them into the court system, given that the building...
That was the part that wasn't clear.
Sorry.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Seeing none. Would you like to come back up, sir?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Yeah. The first thing that I want to point out is, to my knowledge, prior to receipt of the order, there was no notification to Active that the building was in non-compliance by the city. So the first indication to Active that there was anything wrong was when the order was served on Active. And what I'm told is, It's impossible for Active to know whether or not it's in full compliance, especially when the question of compliance are minor deficiencies that pop up on a daily basis. So again, I say it's unfair to impose a fine where there's no time given. No notice given of the deficiencies and no time given to correct them. And in fact, that's the way that we reacted to this. On first notice about some deficiencies dealing with stairwells or crawl spaces, a couple of smoke detectors, a few hinges, some mailboxes, Active moved fairly quickly. It didn't take them very long to get all the deficiencies corrected and to perform. So I think that the fine is inappropriate, not appropriate for this situation. The fine might be appropriate in a situation where there's been complete neglect, complete non-compliance over a period of, say, 30 years, because the bylaw dates back to 1986. Active has been in substantial compliance with the bylaw since 1986, and then it gets notice that there are some minor deficiencies, and therefore there's a fine imposed of $5,000. That's just not fair.
Fair enough. Any other questions? Nope. See you. Thank you very much, sir. We're going to now make a decision.
It's all yours. What do you think? Yeah. Okay. My first official council duty is FCM president.
I'm just doing that to bug you, Sean.
I know.
I know you're sitting
know.
Here in a moment. Okay. Let me see. Where are we? I've just got, excuse me a moment. I just have to find the right spot. I'm on the wrong spot here. Let me go back here. Okay, so we do them separately, items 2 and 3?
Yeah, we will, yeah.
I move that the receipt of representations be concluded.
All support, opposed, carried.
And I move that the appeal be allowed, and does that mean that the decision's canceled? It's just about, all we're dealing with today is the $5,000 fine, and I do want to give a bit of an explanation. Yeah. We've had a lot of these, and the purpose of doing this is to make sure we get all these buildings in safety compliance. It obviously worked in this case. The person is 100% in compliance. The one issue, in compliance, it's a difficult situation with people not having been formally aware, or, you know, it was hard. There's an issue of people knowing that they needed to do this over 30 years, but still, there's an issue with that. And then the last issue that we're not really dealing with by waiving this is that it's still going to cost us money to enforce it. And I'm sensitive to that. And I know our administration is too. And it's a really difficult situation. And I know we can't afford it. But at the same time, it does seem to me somewhat unjust if they've done it immediately. And also in this case, the minor nature of the repairs, you know, it's not like they left this building in bad shape for many years. So and for those reasons, I chose to move them. In this case.
All support. Opposed, carried.
And I move that the appeal hearing be concluded.
All support, opposed, carried.
Okay. And item three, is that the exact same decision? Okay. So I move the receipt of public representation be concluded.
All support is carried.
And I move the appeal be allowed and the decision of the appeals of the Development Inspections Division, PP&D, be cancelled. And I move that the appeal hearing be concluded.
All support post carried. Thank you, everybody. Moving back now, I see number one, I believe, Drew Tran. Are you here?
It's Diane Cullen.
Diane Cullen? On behalf of the appellants. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, David. I can't even remember anymore.
Exactly the same answer.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, it's
so instantly.
Right. All right.
Then we would have been able to impose it. I know. That's why we're here.
Hello, Diane. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
Good, good. So you're going to be here on behalf of the appellant then? Your sister, I think?
Yes, because my father see back in Winnipeg here, mm-hmm. and then my father sick badly now, so she had to come back to Toronto on May 27.
Okay, well, that's fine.
So,
are you getting us information? Well, the clerk will, you just have a seat, mm-hmm. you relax.
Yes.
The clerk will come and get the information from you.
Okay.
Diane, have you done this before?
No.
No. Okay. So we'll give you up to 10 minutes to speak for the councillors here, Councillor Dobson, Councillor Shabazzi, and myself.
Yeah. And he is the picture. You have the three coffee, right?
You can share them too.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
Do you need them back?
Yes, later.
Can I keep them, or do you need these back?
Can I get the bag?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, you sold them? You have one more.
All ready, Diane?
Yes,
yeah,
there's the same.
Yes, the same.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, tell us why you're appealing this today.
Because we process finished it, this building. We, as you can see, it's a stair. The side stair had been made, and the stair go down to the basement also had been made, and the frame in the building in the basement we also have built already, and on the main floor is almost finished. Right, so therefore, it's we comply with the order, right? So it's therefore I need you accept my appeal for Tu Chan Kung that we have on her. Yeah.
Okay. Any questions? I have some to the administration. But generally, you're saying the work that they told you to do, you've done it.
Yes, we have done, yes.
Okay. All right. We'll follow up with the administration. Anything else you'd like to add? You'll have a chance to come back after we talk to the administration.
Okay.
Okay?
Yes.
Do I have a seat?
Okay.
And we'll just do that.
Okay.
Anybody else in support of this appeal that'd like to speak? Anybody in opposition? Anybody for information? Moving on. Councillors, administration?
Yeah, I'd like to hear from them about their perspective on this. I guess the main question is the work that was requested in full compliance with what's been asked?
Sure. I'll answer your question first, and I'll try to give some background.
Yeah.
I don't believe so. And this appeal, although we tried to work with the appellant to explain to her that the order was issued actually to their benefit,
There was an existing order issued in 2010, a Schedule A order, which embedded within that order a prohibited occupancy requirement. We had separated that out and reissued it under a different order for the main reason that, number one, if there was full compliance with the Schedule A order, we can close that order, number one, and leave the prohibited occupancy until it was determined to be safe. Second, if it remained within the Schedule A order that was issued in 2010, the appellant would be subject to annual inspections on an ongoing basis until it was fully closed. So it was a reissuance of an order that is currently in existence with the appeal period far past. We separated it from the other order so that we can create, number one, some efficiencies, and number two, some potential savings for the appellant.
But back to the work, the appellant's indicating that all the work is done. Have you guys checked that work to see if it's done, or have we signed off on this now?
No, our staff was there this past, actually yesterday.
Yesterday.
I have some pictures I can work.
But generally you're saying, contrary to the appellant's viewpoint, the work, you're not ready to say yes, the work is all complied, we're all happy.
No, no. Not according to the pictures we
have. Yeah, there's not even a formal review yet. Okay.
Right.
All right, any other questions?
And the issues we're talking about are matters of...
There are matters of
primary
structural
concern
safety.
Structural safety.
We have pictures from 2010, which really demonstrate a person showing their arm through a hole, which is in the foundation of the building.
Yeah.
And so the prohibited occupancy is to ensure that life safety issues, so it cannot be occupied.
So, what exactly happens with the approval of if we were to deny the appeal, they would be required to do the repairs within a certain time frame, or there would be additional consequences?
No, this appeal is
exactly
on right. This appeal is on an order specifically for prohibited occupancy. Correct.
Yeah.
That prohibition is already in effect based on our order issued in 2010. Mm-hmm. So if the committee decided to deny or uphold the appeal, it would still be in existence,
okay,
just not on a separate order, which we are trying to do to create that efficiency.
That's
okay. Right. Dobson?
These pictures are fairly recent.
Yesterday.
And there's no power hookup.
That's correct.
Okay.
Can I say something?
No.
Not yet. At the end, you can. Okay, anybody else? Any other questions, administration?
No, thanks.
Okay. Okay, back to you now, ma'am.
Yes, the electric company, they tie up right now. They, as you see, they hook up already, but they need to call the inspector, come to inspect the building for electric, and but he tied up right now. He might call the inspector coming this week to inspect, then have the power for the whole building.
Okay.
Yes. And the fun step did not done because it's we need to do the concrete step, but right now we have the side step, so we can go by the side step. Go inside the building. We can go by the side step because the front step we want to do the concrete step, and we're waiting for the contractor come to do on that.
Okay. That's about it. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Make your decision now.
Yeah.
Dobson?
Yeah, okay. I move that the receipt of the public representations be concluded.
All support, opposed, carried.
Aye. That the opposition support.
Okay. That the appeal be denied and the order of the Community Bylaw Enforcement Services Community Services Department be confirmed.
All support, opposed, carried.
And the reason I say that is because it's the building's not ready yet. It's not finished.
Correct.
I appreciate that they're working on it, but until such time as they're finished, I can't support this.
All right. Question. All support. Opposed. Carried.
That the appeal hearing be concluded.
All support. Opposed. Carried. That's it, Matt. We did not grant your appeal.
No.
No, we did not grant it.
Yeah.
No. So you got to follow the order that you've been given. And Andrew, the clerk can send you a letter outlining the next step.
But the inspector for electric will come to inspect this week, right?
Keep working on it, man. You still have to finish the job.
We also inside already done, almost done.
You need to get an inspector. Until you're actually done, right now the clerk will send you the letter. Keep working with the inspectors. Complete your building. But we have denied your appeal. Okay? The council want a 5-minute stretch, or do they want to move right in?
Two address points, not one.
I see them very engaged and excited.
To leave the building.
We're moving on.
One step's ready, the other one's not.
Delegations?
Oh, yeah, no kidding.
You guys
should
jump.
No, exactly.
Are we that now?
Yes, yeah, we should.
Yeah.
We have Susan Russell from McGowan Russell Group and Norm Boyle, North Grassy Properties, to be heard with respect to the Development Agreement Amendment filed DAS at 18 of 2014, which is item 6 on the agenda.
Have everybody seen the, should be speaking, and it sounds like, have we sent their list?
No.
The amendment? Yeah, they probably won't have any idea what Susan's talking about unless they have the amendment.
Okay.
Have a seat, Susan. We'll just go ahead and the... This amendment came up this morning. This is to item, what is it, 6? Whatever it is. Yeah, this is 6. So they actually have any idea what we're talking about. Okay, so that's what it is. We're good. Mark's here. We're all good. Okay, go right ahead.
Yes, so I just wanted to thank everyone for their help on this. And just to confirm, we agree 100%. Just wanted to confirm that the original clause approved by community committee will be left as is, and then what the administration is going to do is add the additional information proposed by water and waste. So there'll be a second clause that will be added. So just want a confirmation that that is what will happen. And,
okay. We can get that confirmation from the administration when we ask some questions.
Sounds good.
Okay, thank you. Good turn. All right.
Thank you.
Okay, anybody, no, wrong system. Yeah, okay, we'll get back to that item then later on. What, do it now, because it's fresh in our mind? Move to number one? I think Mark wants to stay more in the afternoon, so.
Well, I've got a few items on here, so we're good.
We'll do it 1 and 28 for Mark. Okay, do you want, well, it's fresh in our minds, so you want to move on number 6 to number 1 on the agenda? Counselors?
Let me just check here. Sure. You want to move number 6 to number 1? I mean, I don't think it matters. I don't like moving things around.
Well,
if it's just going to be a minute or two, it just becomes a thing we do all the time.
Fair enough.
It's just crazy.
I like simple.
Yeah, okay. Simpler the better.
You got her. Okay, so that's it for delegations.
It won't take
long. Not hearing any?
You need that contract.
Go, sir. Okay, moving on. Moving on to reports. Number 1, subdivision rezoning, 578 Jesse Avenue.
This was at City Center, and we concurred with the administration. So I just move that it goes forward. It's ready to go.
Ready to go.
Yep.
All support.
Aye.
Opposed. Carried. Moving on to
Raiden. We're working you too hard.
See your best work.
I guess Fred brings up too.
We're gonna stall.
Extension of time.
I should have given him a harder time, really.
Extension of time. 839 Pennant Road.
Is this just a straightforward extension of time?
Correct. Yes.
Everyone's good?
Answer Dobson, yep. And all okay. Support yep. Okay. Extension of time, proposed subdivision rezoning, Gunston. All in support?
Yeah.
Proposed carried. Here comes Travassi. This one is development agreement, Ridgewood South, opposite Cardiff Avenue, north of CNR Mainline, Ridgewood West Land Corp. Any questions to the administration on this one? High level, guys?
I don't think I had any. unless there's anything that you're concerned
about on
it.
No, pretty straightforward.
It looks straightforward.
The clause in the subdivision conflicted with the secondary plan in terms of the location of an active transportation trail. This just corrects.
So it makes it can work in terms of the active transportation plans.
It's late.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Okay. All in support. I move the Governor Dobson. All in support. Opposed. Okay. Carried. Number five, development agreement filed as 15-2013, AG 15-13. This one was, any questions on those ones?
Again, straightforward, just to...
There's no concerns with that?
No, the developer had to wait for underground works to be completed before it can complete the paving of Ralston.
So. Right, so this,
moved by Councillor Gervasi, all supported, opposed, carried. This is the one, number six, is the one that we have the amendment for.
We just looked at it, yeah.
We just looked at it and everyone's in agreement and it's all worked out.
Well, we provided the wording to the clerk for the additional condition.
The wording, so this is an additional amendment.
This will become recommendation two and then we'll just renumber all the remaining recommendations.
So we'd be, okay, so the motion would be to support that as amended?
As amended?
Yeah.
Okay. Councillor Dobson, all support, opposed, carried. this one here, Councillor Gervasi pointed out last night, just on a clerical. It's in the it's not in the Fort Gary, Riverbanks Fort Gary ward.
Oh,
it's clerical.
That's quick.
Yeah, John. John doesn't mind if we add White Ridge into his ward.
We're loving people. just a clerical. Okay, so this is an assignment of the development agreement from A to B. Any questions?
Any concerns from administration? It's a straightforward housekeeping kind of thing.
Yeah, more housekeeping.
Yeah, okay. No?
I'll move by Councillor Gervasi. All support, opposed, carried. Addition to the street name reserve list, very fine.
Is this something that needs to be referred to admin? Probably for analysis at this point.
Yes, admin for report.
Came from community committee.
Moved by Councillor Dobson. Yep. All support, opposed, carried. Additional to the street name reserve list, private Davy Drive.
Again, the same thing. I believe it's not been reviewed yet, so it needs to be referred.
Review report. Back.
Yeah.
Moved by Councillor Gervasi. All support, opposed, carried. Where am I? Oh, this one. Number 10. The development improvement strategy for Transcona Cemetery and Chapel.
So this one we have. We don't have the report here today. Do we need to discuss it today if we don't have a report? A verbal update? Yeah. Okay.
Number of moving parts in this one, and Jane Saxby sends her apologies. She's unable to join us this morning. We have, in coordination with the Office of Public Engagement, done significant public consultation, as identified in Recommendation 1. We've updated our web page, done news releases, done surveys both locally and online and throughout Transcona. The two issues at play are the actual rehabilitation, and primarily that's the drainage issues in the old part of Transcona Cemetery and the Transcona Cemetery Chapel. The chapel, we're still evaluating options in terms of what our plan is. We'd love to preserve it. But can't do so in its current location due to drainage issues. So we are looking at options and we'll report back ideally in September on that part of it. And the councillor, we've met with Councillor White as well to discuss cemetery and drainage issues. He's actually offered to fund a drainage study out of his land dedication reserve. So we're going to be putting forward a report substantiating that request and putting dollar value to it.
Is 100% of the funding going to come from this ward? 100%? Because that would be required,
for the study.
I think, for it to be make sense. For the study.
For the study.
Yeah, I understand. I just, even for the study, it's just, you know, I
at this
know
point,
there's
I'm
concerns
not even sure
about
it,
what, how realistic the proposal is. We want to make sure that...
And I don't even know if it'll meet the criteria of the Land Dedication Reserve Fund either.
No.
It won't. It's not really what Land Dedication Reserve funding is meant for, so... I'm not sure that's, like, the administration supports doing something outside of the policy.
Just relaying what the council told us.
That's what he's asking. You're not saying that you're suggesting that or putting that forward?
Would that come out of your point, then?
So if he's requesting that the funding be expended out of that fund, we'll put forward the request to the appropriate parties and their own design.
It'll be Councillor Wyatt's job to put through an LDR application that will get denied, and then he needs to come to council and ask for a waiving of it. criteria.
Yeah, that would be the process for that, and that would be the first step.
It would have to go to council if it doesn't meet criteria.
Yeah, it's required to not, it doesn't meet criteria. With ward councillor support, it goes to council for decision.
So you've identified sort of basically a political issue in a sense. I mean, I'm trying to understand what the administrative position is here, but you don't take one on that.
We think it's a study is required. It's very critical before we dig or move any soil or change drainage patterns in a cemetery. We need a fuller investigation.
We need the information, but normally...
How it's funded was something we'll pursue with the councillor. I think he has suggested he'd be willing to use his land dedication. It wouldn't meet criteria. It would require council.
Yeah, it would have to go to council. And so what are we asking today?
Nothing, just information.
We're giving a verbal update. Yeah. And what I'm hearing is that the draft, the rehabilitation plan, we're asking for a layover till September.
Yes, please. Yeah, okay.
So there's some more work that needs to be done, and these things will come forward more. I just think it is a bit premature to get into all this. It sounds like there's the information we don't have in front of us that's kind of we're talking about but not really talking about. So why don't we wait till we can have a full conversation?
Oh, yeah. Just providing a verbal
update. No, and I'm not criticizing you it's just these types of issues, there's not much benefit to speculating about.
Moved by Councillor Gavassi to lay the matter over.
I think we should just
move it.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All support.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. This one here, number 11 cell towers near residential developments. This was, I guess Councillor Gavassi can take the chair.
Yes, sure. Go ahead, John.
I'd like to move that the new just be approved. And that the new developments and the therefores, planning for new developments be referred to the R Winnipeg process, which we're doing right now. And the second, therefore, which is for infill, be moved to the infill guidelines that we're presently working on.
I just have, thank you, Councilor Roller. I do just have a quick procedural question. This was a council motion, so does that recommendation go back to council and then it would go be referred to those processes? Okay. Just to understand the process properly. Okay. Yeah.
It's actually a very good motion because cell towers are part of life now and we should plan for them.
Well, you'll see the debate. It will be a debate when it comes up, but at this point, we're just going to see if we incorporate some of our planning and see what we can do.
It gives us a chance to find out more about the issues of the
issue. But we will be having
this
glorious debate about cell phone towers, and the public will also have the opportunity to weigh in about the debate at a later date.
We've had some experience with those debates.
It was quite a passionate debate. Yeah.
Okay, so the motion, you've got that. Any further discussion on it? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Carried. Back to you.
Thank you very much. This is number 12, undertaking a comprehensive housing needs assessment for Winnipeg.
Okay.
Councillor Bassey, you want to?
Sure. With my role as chair of housing, Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee, we've been working on a lot of different things on housing. It was identified that there does need to be a comprehensive housing needs assessment. So we would like to move forward with this. Of course, we want everything faster than it probably can be, but it's here, and we would they've come up with really what this is, what we're voting on today, is just identifying the funding to do it and agreeing to do that. And it's taking money from the Housing Rehab Investment Reserve to do this study, which we have available to do it, and it needs council approval to change the rules to allow us to use that source of funding. So that's really what we're voting on today. It's a study that does need to be done regardless of whatever other things we do in housing. So that's basically what we're voting on today. So I would be happy to move it. I don't know if there's any further.
Moved by Councillor Gavassi. All support, opposed, carried.
Thank you.
Number 13, Winnipeg Police Service Headquarters Redevelopment Project Transfer of Funds Report. Okay, do you have any questions? We want administration now.
I was just going to say, I've already been to the movie because this was at Finance Committee, this exact issue, was it not? And so I know it's made a whole new, the gift that keeps on giving, we can be beaten with this, you know, it just keeps coming back like a bad dinner. But the fact is I was on a different standing committee that had this exact same issue. It's already been approved. This is just like almost a housekeeping matter to deal with it, but it is rather painful, and it's more of the pain. But I don't really know what else there is to discuss about it. I think it's been discussed a lot, and it's heartbreaking. that there's been so many difficulties with this file, but I mean, there's really, I don't know what else there is to say other than to try to beat people up more for things that were done long ago, and we're still feeling the pain of, so I don't know what else to say, but it's here, and it's that's what it is.
Yeah, as much as I don't like it, it's a requirement. It's necessary, is it not?
Absolutely.
Then I'm hooped.
Yeah, we're hoping that we will be able to get, exactly. This is one of those ones where, the money, it's going to be transferred. Why it's here is because, and I was very happy to find this out as well, that this is the committee that needs to move budget lines from have the authority to do so. But I believe it still goes up to the council. It stops here.
No, I believe you're just reallocating funds from existing accounts.
So we don't have to keep talking about it. I'm sure we will anyway.
And we will, in the report you'll see, we will be trying to recover why that design flaw was there, and be trying to recover from that design failure.
So there's an opportunity to recover the funds that they're working on. Yeah. In the meantime, we have a source of revenue to deal with within the budget that we're just moving around to, within the existing budget for the project.
And it is affecting, it doesn't have a, it's a safety issue for our staff, and it also has a significant issue on this firearms investigation analysis section. They really need to get it done.
Yeah, they need to get it moving. It's something
it's very unfortunate, but again, we're here to move a budget line around, existing budget money, but of course we'd all prefer to have that money back.
Excellent. Okay.
All in support?
Aye.
Close carry. Now we're moving on. Moving on to our...
Is this the one about the letter of opposition?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. To the list of historical resources.
Okay, so if you don't mind me saying something as chair of the Committee of Historic Buildings and Resources. Now, this one, we do have a letter we received from the owner not wishing it to be designated. I don't believe we have anybody here registered to speak to it, but I believe a letter at this level under the bylaw means that there's opposition, and that means that our decision needs to go up to council.
Correct.
Is that correct, Mr. Clerk? So, I mean, the Historic Buildings and Resources Committee believes that this building should be designated, and that's our recommendation, and we've identified the character-defining elements. It's unfortunate you're seeing more and more of owners in opposition, only because we're going through all these buildings that have been on a list a long time and not actually been evaluated. And also, I believe there's some lack of understanding of the flexibility we actually do have with a designation in terms of heritage permitting, and that it doesn't mean your building is frozen and you can't do anything with it. And we're very, very good at working closely in terms of our department with the property owners, and I'm confident that many of the concerns people have had, and you know, they just don't want the idea of it, but it is a heritage asset for all Winnipeggers, and we should be protecting these assets. So unless there's a really, really, like, I haven't seen a reason to change, to not continue to support the HVRC on this one, from the letter from the owner. That's my
move to put it on. Okay, so the recommendation of Councillor Gervasi is that
go forward to designate with the defining elements.
All in support, opposed, and carried.
Yeah.
Andrew, do you want to say it goes whatever your skill is?
No, it's going to council, as Councillor Gervasi mentioned.
Okay.
Nomination of the tea company.
Now, this one we don't have any opposition for. The recommendation, again, to designate. It's actually amazing how much work the HVRC is doing, I just want to say, and their volunteers. Okay. They're going through all these buildings. We're whipping through them. It's a lot of detailed work, so thank you to them. Yep. And this is another one, and there's no opposition listed here, so this one would end here, I believe.
Yep. Correct.
Yeah. If we approve. And I would move that we approve this one. This
support.
130 goal. Okay.
All support, opposed, carry.
The Scott Bathgate, I'm particularly happy with. Is there anyone in opposition to this one?
Okay.
This is the Nutty Club building. It's an iconic Winnipeg building. I'm super excited. But I actually got a few letters from people from outside of Winnipeg who love this building and within Winnipeg. So I'm pleased that there's no official opposition here to this one as well. And it's certainly iconic, so it's nice to see it here, and I'd move that one as well. And the last one?
This was a request, I believe.
There was a request to delay it?
Delay till September?
Yeah, the owner requested postponement. They're allowed to do so under the bylaws. So they requested to the fall, but I don't specifically know what the fall means. So if you want to suggest the
September.
Okay.
September's fine. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So
September meeting.
So move it over to September. All support. Opposed. Carried.
Okay.
I'm fine with that.
Good.
Moving on. Daycare center. Yay. 3448 Gemini. Any questions? Everybody's happy?
This one seemed pretty straightforward. There's no concerns. We've got a daycare.
Daycare.
Norbert.
All in support?
Aye.
Moved by Councilor Jaffe. All support. Opposed. Carried.
We're working you guys hard today.
Oh, wait until you said that.
Yeah, wait until we get to there. Change of city-owned land south of 188 Pannett Road with adjacent lands at 881 Pannett for the Pannett Road Molson Street reconstruction and twinning project.
Can we ask your administration on that?
Yeah, I guess that would be...
make him sit down anyway.
Welcome. Welcome to the table. Okay, Councilor Dobson?
Yeah, what exactly are you doing there? It seems to be the same address.
There's a land exchange between the... there we go. Public Works wanted to widen Pannett Road. Mm-hmm. So in 2015, the city acquired the land as subject city property from the province, which is that long, narrow parcel to the south of 811 Pannett. And in order to acquire the land from 811 Pannett, we're proposing a land exchange between the land we acquired, subject city property, and the proposed acquisition.
Is there... that part that we have, is there a value to it?
Yeah, we paid approximately $25,000 in 2015 to the province. So the value between the two parcels, the part that we're acquiring and the part that we're selling, are effectively the same. The parcel we bought from the province was an unbuildable lot, so that's why the value was lower than what the value is attributed to the land from 811 Pannett.
Lot, I guess.
It's an unbuildable lot. Yeah, yeah, I don't know why the province had it. It's just been retained for a long time. So it's a low value on that. There's a higher value on the 811 Pannett site. Yeah. So effectively, it's a straight up exchange. Yeah.
Okay, that's all I want.
Moved by Councilor Dobson.
Yep.
All support and opposed. Carry. Moving on, number 26, Urban Design Advisory Committee nominations. Councilor Gavassi.
Yeah, I can move that.
All support and opposed. Carry. Downtown Development Project, Center Venture Development Corporation. Oh, hi, Angela. How are you?
We've already finished delegation.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I think we, do we need to hear from her?
Or
are we okay? I don't have a concern with that. It's gone over with the administration.
Yeah, no, the administration is supportive. It allows Center Venture to enter into engagement with the adjacent property owners, and it's to make those parcels more developable. And so we see this as a positive. The reason this committee is seeing it is it falls out of the asset agreement, which had an expiry clause on it. And because of that, these fall outside the asset
agreement.
They have
agreement. To come
we
here had, now.
Yeah, and so now they come here.
Yeah.
And we're looking to renew the asset agreement with Center Venture. But these are ones that have an opportunity to move forward sooner.
Okay, I'm good.
My question is, these projects, and this is why I actually having Angela up, she's a great cheerleader, about the project. So, no, it's too late now. I wish it, but again, I'll just sort of look over to make sure I'm okay. So we're talking about the pump house?
Correct, yes.
And then the other one, is that part of?
It's Waterfront and Galt.
And that's in the end part, more where the flying saucer is?
Moving in that direction, yes.
Yeah, so that's where we're looking at one. And the third one is?
North of Disraeli, just around McDonald Avenue. And really, these are leftover parcels that are surplus the city of Winnipeg needs, and in fact allow some of the projects, particularly the pump house, to move forward.
Right. And the other projects they have pending, maybe we know, maybe we don't yet, because that's the Development Corporation's job, but that, they're moving forward in these areas with projects.
Yeah, and those are guided and led and facilitated by Center Venture.
Yeah.
Hence, we enact the land transaction, they enact the deal.
Yeah, and it's quite exciting. There's those projects right now are, they've been back in that area. It's a very exciting part of the neighborhood.
and becoming a very active neighborhood. So I just want to commend Senator Benjamin for the work you're doing on that. It's quite impressive. So all the support, Rebecca Thompson,
yep. Yep.
Carried. Report to reestablish a fee.
Oh, yes, this one.
Winston thought he'd be back in a couple of hours because he wasn't sure how fast we would get through.
He's not used to us moving like this quickly.
Yes. I'm happy to speak on Winston's behalf in his absence. There was a previously established fee. When the new fees and schedule was brought in for vacant buildings, it was eliminated. This is simply and that was seen as administrative oversight. And in fact, there's a fee to make an appeal. It's more of a nuisance fee to slow down the number of people appealing and taking up committee time simply because it's an opportunity. Why not? And so, in essence, this reestablishes a fee that had been in place before that inadvertently had been left out.
Will that, at that point, when this comes in, will we be making a decision whether it is...
And it is refundable.
Warranted?
Yes, it is refundable.
No, but I'm saying, will we be making a decision every time?
They come here, they do their appeal.
Yes.
And we said, yeah, you had merit.
But that's what I'm trying to say. We're going to have to say that it has merit, and then we're going to have to make.
If the appeal is upheld, they get their appeal feedback.
Okay.
It's refundable. Yeah.
Their appeal is not upheld, but they have some merit. There's just not enough merit. How does that work? Merit is pretty general.
That's pretty subjective.
As in.
It says, I was asking the same question Councillor Thompson was going to ask.
It says in good faith and has merit. Like
we were allowing the committee to be King Solomon, I guess.
Show up and they try.
Yeah.
And
in some cases, there may be communication back and forth. I think what you saw this morning is there may have been some merit. There wasn't in this case. But in essence, staff are still going out, having to take pictures, do the follow-up the day before, those kinds of things. So it depends where the line gets drawn. If the appeal is rejected, well, of course, they pay it. If there's extenuating circumstances, we didn't want it to be just black and white. There may be extenuating circumstances.
So we got a little bit of playroom.
Yeah.
Perfect. I'm good with that.
Yeah. And I just want to point out, this was an administrative mistake not to just keep the fee going. Like, it wasn't like council said we should stop having this fee. This isn't a new fee. We had the fee. It was accidentally not put in.
Somewhere
like,
along the way.
I don't like to blame the staff, but this isn't our fault.
If I was Winston, I'd be willing to accept the blame. Yes.
I think Winston would gentlemanly accept the blame.
Yes.
But the point is that this isn't adding a new fee.
No.
This is we had a fee, and we're just getting back to it where it should have been if it had been written into the line where it was meant to be.
Correct.
Okay, I just want that to be really clear. Okay, thank you. It's pretty straightforward because you do get people coming in and just like, oh, it doesn't cost anything, and then we're running around with all these appeals. If it has any merit at all, the council could
correct.
Be quite lenient on it. We usually are softies.
It's okay. I just talked. That's a little. We'll prove it today if you're so willing. But probably at EPC before it gets to council, we'll clarify that merit part of it.
Yes. Might want to tighten it up a little. Yeah,
okay.
So we understand.
Good faith and merit, yeah.
But
it's just because we need to make a separate motion each time, so Andrew has a little homework.
Yeah, just okay. To make sure it's really clear that that could easily be done.
Because that's another decision we have to make.
Right.
Whether we support,
we better make sure to get it in
support
the appeal
or deny the appeal, plus does it have merit? So that's two decisions versus one.
But one thing that's clear is that if the appeal is successful, they're not paying the fee.
Correct.
And then we're even saying if there's, we're trying to define that in-between part.
The extenuating circumstances that might be applied.
And we have compassion.
We understand the direction.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll have community services then connect with the clerks to get that clarification. All right.
Okay.
Yep. All support?
All right.
Opposed, carried. Assignment Development Agreement, AG 1481, subdivision zoning, North Bellevue Road to east of Eric Street. I think that's the assignment over.
Yeah, very straightforward.
Any questions?
Nope.
Seeing none, all support. Opposed, carried. Number 24, land exchange of city-owned land at the rear of 640 Beecher Avenue, parcel B, plan 29263 with land acquired for the street widening at 650 Beecher Avenue.
in essence, this is a land exchange for, you know, and Councillor Dobson raised it for clarification on the last land exchange. This is remarkably similar. So it's alignment of the street right-of-way in exchange for property on the other side.
And the values are approximately the same.
Correct. Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Councillor Dobson, all support, opposed, carried. Sorry, it's going to take surplus land. It was already the place.
Oh, okay. Right, yes, sorry.
All right, we've got a conversation with Councillor this morning. Was kind of a moot point. All right.
Oh,
well, just, that's all right. Okay, no big deal.
All right. Previously,
okay with it,
previously declared surplus. Yes.
Okay.
The public service was actually ahead of it itself.
Yeah. Well, my reports. That's why.
Yeah.
What item are we on now?
I think we're on 25 now.
We're on 25 now.
Yeah. Reassignment. Okay. That's right. Reassignment of offer to purchase for the sale of 659 Furby Street.
This was went to market twice. We're recommending the sale for the price of $55,000.
It's just a different buyer now? Or
it's
just a different buyer?
Yeah, and in essence, we come to this committee where there's a variance on the appraised value. Our appraised value is, you know, as we say, a notional indicator. Went to the market twice. The market tells you, in essence, what it's really worth. And so this is the number, and we feel comfortable from our perspective that it's a good thing. They intend to build on it. We will have it back on the tax rolls.
Just to clarify, though, we've already agreed to this purchase, the sale of the land.
Mm-hmm.
And this one's only about moving it from somebody to somebody else.
Correct. So it's
Okay. Moved by Councillor Devassi. All support, opposed, carried.
Okay.
What?
This one is in my ward. It's the Wildwood project.
So this is the North Drive, right?
It's the golf course, and it's a fairly complicated one. And I guess I'd like to ask the administration to speak to us,
sure,
and give us sort of the explanation of what this report is.
This ties in both golf services and real estate. In the simplest sense, we have some unbuildable land that we would be conveying at market value to the development that's adjacent. A flood wall has to be constructed related to the private development. It has an impact, a slight impact on the parking lot for golf services at Crescent Drive. And the recommendation will be a separate report coming forward from the public service regarding the proceeds of the suggested how to direct the proceeds of the value of the land. And so, in essence, from golf's perspective, I maybe just turn over to Al Shane. And
what we're hoping for, councillors, is that when the land is sold, that the money will be transferred over to golf services to be used as part of funding on behalf of the city for the clubhouse, the building of a new clubhouse, which was torn down. So my understanding is that the McGowan Group is going to be putting $280,000 towards this project. The hope from golf services is that the $40,000 from this sale will be transferred to golf, along with the previous sale of $180,000 for a portion of the parking lot earlier this year. That would mean the city's contribution would be $220,000. So combined, we'd have $500,000, which would give us a good starting point. We're anticipating that the value of a clubhouse with parking lot would be somewhere in the neighborhood of $700,000 to $800,000 to build, and would be moved to the far side of the golf course on land that's buildable off of Riverbank code doesn't apply. So the money would then, so we're going to take the money from the sale of the land, the parking lot, which right now the parking lot has no use for us, take the proceeds from that, use it as our contribution towards the clubhouse, and jumpstart that project in 2017 to get a clubhouse built.
And this is one of those shared sites where there's both tennis and golf. There's a lease for management agreement with a group to run the golf, maintain, look after those kinds of things. So, in essence, it's we're viewing it as a positive, and allows a flood wall to be developed in an appropriate location for the private entity developer.
The parking lot right now, as it stands, is of no value to golf services because there's no clubhouse there. So really, if we didn't sell the land to them, what we would be left with is a part of a parking lot that, in my opinion, would eventually be used by the residents of the condos. It's a parking lot adjacent to the condo development. So my thought is that we would sell the land because it has no value to us, and then use that money for something that has a value to us. And one thing I want to mention is that the old clubhouse was on private land, so it wasn't owned by the city of Winnipeg, so the city had no assets. by building a new clubhouse on city land, we assume that asset. So right away, the city would be assuming an $800,000 asset, whereas before we had no asset.
So basically, the land has no value to us, or the parking lot has no value to us right now. We can't use it.
That's correct. It's being used, temporarily. Like, it's still used for parking because they have a temporary clubhouse. Yeah. But eventually, when the condominium development is finished and we move forward, that land will have no value to us.
Okay. Correct.
And we really need to have a clubhouse on our golf course, and this is a way to do it without going to the taxpayer from yeah. other sources, working with InSight to make it possible, and it's golf course land, so it does kind of make sense that it goes to make the golf course viable. So in that sense, I'm very supportive of the purpose of this. And we know that the developer has made a commitment to contribute. We have an amount they're contributing to the clubhouse.
The developer's on the record with the public service of contributing $280,000 towards the development of the future clubhouse. And in fact, we will be identifying that when we bring forward.
Yeah, so that second report. That's my question is, what's the timelines on all of this? Like, I mean, it's always better to have everything in one report, but we're having one and then the other. Is there a reason for the two separate reports? Maybe you can explain that, because
this really declares the land surplus and allows the sale to be transacted. The second will be about the future of the clubhouse and how it's being built and kind of that process. The reason for separating out the two is really timing. The adjacent property is under construction. Flood wall has to be built going into September, October. This allows council to deal with it this month, construction to continue. Within the month, we anticipate at next standing policy committee, you will be receiving the report on.
Okay, so it's really close. It's
yes.
not, it's not like it's just being conceived of or something.
No.
It's on the way. It's just that we don't want to hold up construction for another month.
Correct.
Because they're already building in there.
Yeah, and so this was fast-tracking to get the flood protection in place, and in essence, the second report will be addressing the allocation of the funds.
Yeah, that report has to be dealt with before construction is complete to ensure that the developer's still around. July Council is something to move forward to.
Yeah.
So the developer will still be, you know, will be held to that.
Correct.
Because it'll be within that time frame, for sure.
And you'll see a report back at next standing policy committee.
Because that's a certainty you kind of need to have. We don't want to be finding out later, now we have. But this will be done before construction is complete.
And currently, Crescent Drive is working out of an extended trailer on site. But Wildwood is in a trailer on site. They continue to operate, and the club continues to operate, and they're maintaining the site. So
I was in that.
We need to keep them viable as well.
Well, this has been, and just to let you know, as the ward counselor, I have been involved in a number of, you know, updates and meetings to work through this problem, you know, just to keep me informed of that there's issues. And there's certainly important to the residents that this is done properly, too, and that, you know, we have a public golf course. It's an asset. This is increasing the value of that asset as well by having it fully functional, and something we really need to do. So I would like to thank the staff for coming up with a creative way of doing this, and I hope the committee will support it. Sorry, I thought you were.
No,
yeah,
the question is more, it's bigger, it's a larger one. So I guess my question is this parking lot, you want to declare a piece of the parking lot surplus, correct? And now that parking lot right now, is that leased by Golf Services, or is that leased by NOI? Is that just city with land?
No.
Everything, the golf course and tennis courts are city land, and that was leased to Wildwood Club, which is now defunct, and the lease has been assigned to 698-1420 Manitoba Limited, which is the McDonald Group's company. So they are the our tenant now, and there's further subleases to the tennis and to the golf.
Okay, so my brain is trying to figure out how I'm going to maybe the next step. And maybe I just put it on the record for you. Generally, what should be happening, what this is doing, and we're having a problem with, as we have more difficulties finding money, administration and individual counselors are trying to grab ward property, the old days we call it. Well, that's my property sold into my ward. So instead of going to land operating reserve, where it should go, we're going to capture that money so it never gets there. And now I got my little piece of the pie because it's my land. Now, this definitely has some different nuances to that. But would not the proper process be that this goes to the land operating, the sale of the land goes to the land operating reserve? And then from there, we just determine if it goes to the bubbles or not?
Yeah, in many cases, yes. In this case, where lands have been zoned PR, or in fact for parks purposes, those funds have been retained within the wards, and that has been... And in this case, the golf course is in fact zoned PR.
I didn't know that. Yeah. You're absolutely right. So even this land, the parking lot, is PR.
Correct.
And I've been one of the biggest champions against what your concern is.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be doing that in my ward. Because I've been, I take it for the team on that normally, but this is unique.
So this one will require about 2/3 from council to do this.
The approval of the sale, yes.
And again, for all ward councils who are out there listening to this right now, if it is a parkland, the general principle is that yes, that land, that value does stay within.
Those funds are retained within
the ward.
Yeah.
But not general land sales. Or,
correct. Okay. And that's the difference between land operating.
There.
Yeah. The difference between land operating reserve and land dedication.
It's unusual to have a private condo development, and then there's also a lease with our running a golf course. Yeah. Like, it's one of a kind situation. It is a park situation.
I'd have to be able to explain to other councils.
Yeah, that's very helpful.
Why did you get the way of this and I can't?
A lot clearer. Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's a park plan.
Yeah.
Done.
Okay. So all in support?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Good. Thank you.
Move to adjourn by Councillor Dobson.
Sure.
Oh. Yep. Report. Of course, Gary.
10:25.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Really? It's 10:25.
Oh, wow. I have a few things to do.